images are ones of lives near ruin, like we have rarely seen before. An Ohio couple slumped over from a heroin overdose with a four-year-old in the back seat. Images of people overdosing in stores or out on the streets. And the sounds can be heartbreaking. A Youngstown father, Brendan Clark, telling his son that his mother has overdosed and died.
Mommy died last week. Okay.
What, you mean my mom?
Yes.
How?
From drugs.
I don't think your viewing public understands the magnitude of the carnage. It's not just a public health crisis, it's a plague.
A plague, drug court judge David Matias says.
What do you need help with?
That is killing more Americans than a war.
Vietnam, the number of people who died in Vietnam was 58,000. We're almost losing that every year. And how many years are we into that?
It's now been almost 5 years since the I-Team first traveled to Southern Ohio to report on an emerging crisis.
I relapsed while I was pregnant with her, and I used until 3 weeks ago.
People overdosing in record numbers on heroin and its legal cousins, opium-based painkillers such as oxycodone and OxyContin.
Ohio has been a particularly hard hit, no question about it.
Chuck Rosenberg runs the DEA, the nation's Drug Enforcement Administration.
Sometimes we overuse certain words like historic or unprecedented. This is an epidemic. We're going to lose 47,000 people this year to a drug overdose death. And remember, in some ways, that number is a significant undercount because we have many, many, many more people who overdose but don't die.
Indeed, just in the small town of Euclid, records show its fire department administered naloxone, the heroin antidote drug, to 145 people last year alone.
I wish that I could say that this was just a temporary thing and it's going to go away, but it doesn't appear. It appears to be getting worse.
What's driving the increased demand for heroin and its opiate cousins?
One of the things driving the increased demand for all opioids are prescription pills. We know that 4 out of 5 new heroin users started on pills. And most people got those pills legitimately, at least at some point.
Given that statement from the nation's top drug enforcement official, you might expect other government policies to encourage doctors to be more careful, to prescribe fewer opiates for their patients to manage pain. But in fact, the opposite is true. Federal policies put pressure, financial pressure, on doctors to prescribe more opiates in the middle of a heroin epidemic.
We know that physicians across Ohio feel strongly that they are being pressured.
My colleagues tell me that the pressure is extremely intense, and that oftentimes, you know, these patients have been on these medications for years.
Both Dr. Jason Jerry at the Cleveland Clinic and Dr. Joan Papp at Metro say they are grateful that their hospitals do not reduce individual doctors' pay based on how patients rate their pain treatment on government surveys. The same is true at university hospitals. Doctors' individual pay does not go down based on patient surveys about pain control.
The messaging is always the same, which is practice good medicine. And so an opioid sometimes is appropriate and sometimes it's not, but it's not based on an HCAHPS question at all.
HCAHPS is the name of the federal survey given to Medicare patients after hospital stays. There are two pain questions, one on pain control and one asking if the hospital staff did everything they could for pain. Patients are given 4 choices, and if they don't answer always to both pain questions, the amount of money the government pays the hospital for their care goes down.
Several hospitals across the country do structure their payment that way.
A study of 1,100 doctors just in Ohio found 74%, about 3 out of 4, felt more pressure to prescribe opioids because of how the government reimburses for pain control.
It's unrealistic to believe that they're not going to cave into that pressure in some cases.
What patients want is not always the best medicine.
Dr. Jerry says all physicians know that reimbursement may go down to their hospitals, and they know that patient satisfaction scores matter a lot.
You feel that, and what are you doing wrong, and that, you know, your satisfaction scores aren't up to snuff with the rest of the institution.
And ask the drug court judge, who sees lives ruined by prescription pills every week.
She's going to be dead.
Ask him about patient scores influencing doctors to prescribe more opiates, and he'll tell you.
It is the exact opposite of what the medical profession should be doing.
So what should be done?
There are many solutions. We have to attack supply. That's the traditional law enforcement response. But we also have to attack demand.
And attacking demand may mean changing a system that encourages doctors to prescribe more pills during an epidemic when people are dying in warlike numbers, one by one.
I'm so sorry.